Welcome, folks. This is Deborah Byrne.
Hi, nice to meet you. Nice to see you again. Mike.
As you can see, her qualifications. We've already grilled her, so I don't know.
Well,
you guys, it's your chance to grill.
Well, can you tell us about yourself, other than what's written here?
Personally?
Yeah.
Sure. I moved to the Green Harbor Marshfield area about 18 years ago from New York. Raising a family. My daughter is 12. I have a stepdaughter who's in college. Working right now down in Quincy. I'm very active volunteer-wise through 4-H in Norwell, which is a barn that my daughter is involved in horseback riding, as well as cheer coach for Marshfield 7th graders. And also Green Harbor Beach Association, which my husband does with me also, which we coordinate events for Green Harbor with Labor Day events and movies on the beach.
Alright, so we're just going to...
So what initially made you interested in applying for this job?
Well, I would definitely say one of the interests are, you know, as you view my resume, I have been with a company for quite some time. The company that I am with, I do stay for a while. I'm looking for a place to call home, to settle down. And unfortunately, the company that I'm with was purchased 3 times now. I don't know if you remember last time when I was here, but we were purchased about 5 years ago through Lateral Group, then through DST, and then 2 weeks ago we were purchased by Brock. So there's been a lot of turnover, a lot of uncertainty, a lot of don't know where the position's going and or going anywhere. So seeing something within a town hall, which is a community, of course, town business, I hope it doesn't go anywhere, but so looking for stability. So that was one of the reasons of why I looked at the town hall as well as the position. I felt as though definitely has many different duties, responsibilities, achievements, qualifications that I feel as though I fit in.
Now, the difference between some of the positions in the town hall and this particular one is that this board meets sometimes. This board here is very, right now, doesn't have a lot of planning issues on it. It doesn't have site plans on there, but right now it just has subdivisions. But sometimes meetings here can go much longer than the average, let's put it this way, the contracted time frames for the rest of the town hall. And I'm assuming that Sabrina, obviously, because she's with the selectmen, and she's in a different position. She's not union.
Sure.
And this is a union position. Hers doesn't have a restriction on time. This particular spot wouldn't really have a restriction on time either, because when we're meeting, sometimes meetings go long.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, they seem to, you know, we probably finish around 9:30 at night for the most part, to 10 o'clock. But in the early days, it used to go to 11. So some nights can be longer, depending on what it is, the project. And then there's the, when we go on a walk, site walk,
sure.
Sometimes it's on a Saturday, usually, or on a Sunday, depending on when the board can meet.
Mm-hmm.
So some of those duties, too, also apply to this type of position. We're looking for someone who's available to be flexible. That would be one of the concerns I would have, is inflexibility.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can answer the concern that you have, being with my background and what I've done in my career. Nothing has been 9-to-5 for me in about the 35 years that I've been working. Because in the sales, hospitality, event planning, secretarial business, those three qualifications of what I've done, nothing has been 9-to-5. Because you have events that start at 6, or you have meetings that start at 6, or unfortunately, everyone's left, and there's another planning committee that we all have to meet and come together, a volunteer group. So I'm used to juggling, you know, those kind of hours. That's okay. I tell you in advance, respectively, I do have something planned that day. There might be something we can work on. I mean, well, things in life work. You know, some things are scheduled with just, you know, just life in general. And then there are pop-up stuff, which we work with.
I forgot my question. So keep going. We'll come back to it.
Well, basically, we meet every other week, mm-hmm. which would be from, basically, as Paul said, from 7:30 or 7 to 9:30, 10 o'clock. Mm-hmm. There will be probably once a month for a Saturday meeting, which would be a site meeting, which we would have to walk as we'll be wherever. Yeah. You know, I assume that this is a salary position?
It is a salary. Well, it's a complicated situation, I think. They've complicated because they made it a union position.
Right.
But that's up to management to figure out how they're going to pay for it.
Mm-hmm. I guess where I was actually going with it is we meet generally. We've been meeting every week, it seems like, for a long time. But generally, we meet every other week.
Yeah. Well, that's what but because of things happening.
Right, so normally, on a normal schedule, we'd meet every other week and then we have some Saturday visits. But one of the complications about this position that made us somewhat uncomfortable with it being a union clerical position mm-hmm. is that in some ways you have the attributes of being a department head mm-hmm. in that we're only meeting periodically mm-hmm. and there's a lot of independent work. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of times when there's no one here who is your direct supervisor.
Sure.
Because the board is your direct supervisor. There may be other mm-hmm. people you can collaborate with or go to, mm-hmm. but your supervisors are a board, not any one person.
Right.
So I guess my question would be, how do you feel about taking on a role that's closer to a department head type role in mm-hmm. terms of being self-sufficient, self-directed, knowing when to reach out, when to handle things on your own?
Well, I think with any position, whether, you know, whoever starts at the position, some of it is going to be trial by fire. You're going to pick up something because someone you told me last time they were here, she was here for 18 plus years. There's been technology, there's been different things that you've wanted to improve on. That's also going to come talking to all seven of you to find out, Jim, you're looking for something with email, you're looking for something more technology-based, you were looking for something, you know, clients, make sure that if you have someone come in that's in. Things are going to happen. It's with a board like this, you're going to have to go through the flow of the day, write things down and call the individual person if there's something to be addressed. I mean, and of course, my own personal professional skills of dealing with the situation and or what I might have in mind of how a filing system and or communication goes is how I have to follow through with it.
One of the big things that happens here is everything that's submitted to this board is time sensitive. I mean, completely, you know, when a developer comes in and submits a set of plans, clock ticks.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So it's a question of going up, submitting that, and having it stamped in, goes up to the clerks, and then making sure that the board
is aware of it,
is complying with that time stamp, or we get extensions.
Mm-hmm.
So Maryland, for the most part, is taking care of making sure that the board's aware that we have to meet, mm-hmm. or we have to get granted an extension of time. And so, and sometimes you're dealing with a conversation from the board, not necessarily alone, to our lawyer, mm-hmm. or the town's lawyer, mm-hmm. and dealing with issues that arise from land planning and things like that. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of things that aren't necessarily in the job description that frankly, I don't necessarily know this board knows.
Right. Well, you might learn them with a new person that's going to be on board. You're going to have to ask questions.
Right, but you know what I'm saying is that the board is not privy to everything that actually occurs here during the day.
Sure.
What the motions are. So it's not like we can actually instruct you to say, listen, take this here and take it there.
Right.
No, but I think that you've been in positions where you've dealt with the public, you've had to deal with
various, you know, committees or people or clients, right?
Oh, absolutely.
But the companies represented had certain kind of procedures and processes in place, right? So give us an example of a time where maybe you had to kind of explain that or find out what those processes were. Maybe there's a new kind of event that came in that required some different things, maybe dealing with a union or dealing with, you know, some labor or something, and how you, you know, came up to speed on those rules and regs.
Well, you have to talk to the key person, first of all, that either that it presented it to you. So you have to find the facts of, okay, well, when is your deadline? What are your hot points? What is the direction of where this needs to be completed? One of the things in my career of what I do, and this will be one of my secrets, is I might give you a deadline of October 1st, but really you have until, let's just say, October 5th to really complete it. And that just gives me the comfort zone in between, because there are going to be some tweaks and problems that are going to be in between there. Also, looking back on history, there must be something, either a program or an email, something that's going to give you some type of clue in regard to a situation or, you know, a change of something that I have to follow through with. Those would really be the two key things, is talking to first the individual that is giving you the information, they're the ones going to have most of it, and then really kind of going back through the email process and or, you know, talking to someone that's going to be somewhere. I mean, there. I feel as though there really is going to be an answer. At one point, am I going to get frustrated? I think anyone would, you know, but as long as though you have your ducks in a row to say, okay, Deb, you have to go, you know, either, you know, go talk to Dan and make sure that the financial statement's coming in or that you've achieved your deadline, and giving myself the grace periods in between, that will help out with anyone who starts in a position.
Yeah. I think, Sue, we're kind of a large board, so there's typically somebody available somewhere.
But for the most part, you know, the planning board agent works with the chair on the agenda.
Yeah.
They'll work with the chair on what's happening for the week. And that's really the main source of communication between.
I think all of us have email and cell phones, with the exception of one person.
Yeah, I understand that, but, you know, it's the chair who kind of sets the agenda
and knows what's going
on. Right. And so I just wanted to ask another question, because you've got such a great, you know, customer service background. That's a big part of what this job is all about. So I'm sure you've dealt with some difficult people at times.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Right. So if you could give us an example of someone, and you can take a second to think about it, because I don't want to put you on the spot either, but an example of a time where you had someone come in pretty hot under the collar and you kind of had to handle that situation. Because we do have people who come in here, and they don't always know what the rules and regs are, and sometimes things are perfectly right with what we're doing, but they don't agree with it. So they can get pretty irate. Sometimes I want to take it out on you.
Oh, no. Yeah, definitely. And it probably will. Empathy is the biggest thing. In the beginning, I will apologize. I will listen to them. I will hear what they have to say. I will probably repeat what they have to say. An instance that I brought up with the board here, my first interview was, we were sitting inside a conference room, and it was actually in the hotel industry. And I was supposed to bring an IT line in through one of the doctors that had a big presentation. This is in conference rooms that are 500-plus people. I was new. I thought I touched all the bases. I touched base with all the different salespeople, convention planners, and when it came down to it, when the conference started, the IT line, the cable was supposed to come from the outside, wasn't hooked up, and that actually has to go through NSTAR. So when I tell you there are some really, really mad doctors who were presenting at the conference, I was in a lot of trouble. And I stood there, and of course you want to cry. The best thing is, though, is honestly to empathize with it, tell them that you're sorry, tell them what the reaction will be as far as concluding, or say, unfortunately, I have to get back to you within an hour, but get back to them within the hour. My biggest thing is, you're looking at me and say, I'll get back to you by 2 o'clock, or I might get back to you by 3 o'clock, because there has to be research. Sometimes answers aren't always given at that very point. But if you can at least talk and tell them, I've heard what you've said, empathize, repeat what they've said, take down your information, I think it does settle a lot of aggravation.
Good. So.
Good. I have to ask you.
Yeah.
Your email.
Yeah.
How did you come up with that?
Stormville 1?
Right.
Oh, it's actually a town in New York that my family's in. So, yeah, so that's where I came out of.
Where is Stormville?
Through White Plains, up that way.
Near Carmel, New York.
Like Carmel? Yeah, do you know
Carmel? Lake Carmel, of course, yeah. My wife's from Carmel.
Really?
Yeah, my sister-in-law and brother-in-law used to live in Stormville.
That's so funny. What's your wife's last name?
Her maiden name was Johnson.
All right, well, that can help me.
All right, the fee and agency at a Bruce.
Oh, sure.
That's my brother-in-law.
That is a small world. See?
Yeah, it is.
That's funny.
All right, I have another question for you. So if we were going to contact three of your references, which three would you have us contact?
To be honest, yeah, I'm comfortable with all of them.
Okay.
I can tell you the relationships if you wanted to write some notes, so you have an idea of who they are. If that's maybe.
Sure.
Elizabeth Fagan was the director of sales at the time at the Hilton in Dedham. From there, she's actually just progressed through the hospitality industry. I knew her from 98 is where I first met her. Jackie McConkey is the finance division manager at, which was DST, which is now our new company, Broadridge. So I have communication with her in regard to clients, purchases, vendor relations. Amy Brown was our former HR director, but the time after her company was purchased, the first time, unfortunately, she was let go through that process. Lynn Williams was, who's now a director at the Cape Cod Resort and Spa for the Catania. She was a co-worker of mine. And Mary Lou, just so you're at a level of where I am now with the company, she's one of the senior client service liaisons who does a process through similar to what I do.
Any other questions?
I think I'm good. We've already met.
Yeah, so we've already.
Yeah.
So this is kind of for you and Paul. So.
Top reason why you applied?
Oh, that's funny. I was asked that earlier. To be honest with you, because of the transition of so many changes I've had in my company, being the fact Pembroke is a hop, skip, and a jump. Qualifications, I feel, as though what I can carry through and come to a town hall and bring my knowledge, I think it could be a right fit. So I just thought it was a good opportunity.
Paul, any last?
Well, I'm just going to bring up that board there, because some members don't necessarily particularly care whether or not we have that board or not. But I'll just tell you what it's for me.
Sure.
I'm not one that's on email. You won't ever see me text you or anything like that. I'll have a cell phone, but I probably won't. But when I sit here, it's a visual.
That's right.
To be able to look at something like that.
Yeah.
And so sometimes for certain people on the board, that might be, that could be improved. Mm-hmm. I think it's an asset. Some people may think some of the older things are not, but realistically, a lot of times when you sit in here, things like that can bring up a recollection of something that hasn't been taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's kind of, for me, my, not a comfort, but it's something that we can look at and reference quickly without having to take a look into a file and bring up notes about something that maybe was lost. And for me, what I would do here, for whichever candidate gets it, is to move subdivisions over and put subdivisions here and put a heading over there, site plan, so that we can tell which site plans are still current, which site plans have been completed and off the table, or coming forward. I don't think we use it.
Some of us are happy with a spreadsheet.
To me, that's a spreadsheet.
But it's not up to date.
That's not up to date.
That hasn't been touched.
Right. So that's my point.
But, you know, and that's okay. You're dealing with so many different people and personalities. That's fine. I mean, even if you walk into any office now, I'll be honest with you, we have whiteboards. Our whiteboards are our goals, or our whiteboards are client active. So if that's what you're comfortable with, that's okay.
Right.
You know, that can still be.
Right. I just think it gives a record. Sometimes people go, well, you know, how many lots are in that subdivision?
Yeah.
It's a quick reference point. So I don't necessarily know in changes that, I mean, it's one of those things that could be updated. Maybe there's maybe something else we could do to improve the way people are.
Well, I think, you know, if I was to take a position, this wouldn't be something that would be changed
right
away.
It's not a high priority.
No, I'm just saying, you know, I'm not one that's going to come in and first of all change something right away. I have to get acclimated with what it is. And then from there, you know, there could still be, I mean, it's easy enough to still send out an email, but you could still update this, you know, that's fine.
Right. But this here would give you a quick synopsis of what actually is still out there.
Yep.
With the site number, the reference number to go and look for in the file.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's a quick reference. It's something that can be used or not utilized or not utilized. So, mm-hmm. It doesn't have to stay. It could be changed, altered, whatever.
I just think it's going to take some time to get that related to.
Oh, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, there's so many. Especially you were saying the person was in the position for 18. That's a lot
years.
To unravel.
20 years.
It's not going to happen overnight.
No, it's not.
Oh.
We don't expect it either.
Right.
It's going to take you some time. Mm-hmm. And some patience.
Mm-hmm.
And to put up with it.
Mm-hmm. Or vice versa. I won't be shy to say that.
No, I think we're certainly patient.
We have our moments.
Let's say one of us doesn't.
Yeah. Excellent. Any last questions?
No, I don't.
No, thank you for coming back.
Oh, thanks for having me. But could you go around and just tell me what department or how you're affiliated with the town hall? I know Jim, I was with you already, and Becky, I was, and Dan. But are there is there like construction, electrical? Are you?
No, we're for the town.
Oh, okay. We're only elected members of the planning board.
Jim is a civil engineer.
Yeah.
By trade.
Correct.
In his own life.
Right. I remember. Yeah.
I'm a construction professional.
Okay.
By trade.
Yeah.
I'm a lawyer and a realtor.
Okay.
Banker.
I'm an electrician, but I'm on two boards. I sit on this board, mm-hmm. and also sit on the DPW.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I'm a local publisher.
Okay.
Great. Excellent. What
was
the
point doing?
I think he's retired. Among other
things. Yeah. You did do mortgage stuff, right?
I think you did mortgage.
Oh, is that what he did?
Yeah.
I think so.
Yes.
Brian has been the keeper of the rules many times.
Yes, right.
Brian would be the one person tell you most of your zoning bylaws and most of your planning board rules and regulations by heart.
Really?
If you want to.
So this is what happens when you don't come to a meeting.
That's why you gotta show up all the time.
Yeah. I gotta show up all the time.
Defend myself.
Defend my reputation.
Excellent. Any questions for us?
I guess what would be the next step in your decision process? What do you, or when do you need to fulfill?
I got one question.
Sure.
How available are you?
Well, I am presently employed. So if I was to be, you know, given the position and things worked out, it would specifically have to give a 2-week notice to my employer. So, and then because summertime, I'll be honest, I do have a vacation planned. So there could be some overlapping with that.
I think we had talked about trying to see if we can reach consensus or agreement tonight on a candidate and then trying to, you know, move the process along fairly quickly so that we can try to have someone in place. But it depends on, after we interview everyone, if everyone's comfortable that we're ready.
To talk to Sabrina, she felt comfortable that the town would be willing to make Marilyn an offer to
stay on as a consultant.
Consult
for some period of time.
Because they've done the same thing with Diane Tobin.
Okay.
And if worse comes to worse, we'll all just take a day in there. Get the lay of the land.
And as far as a position with benefit, I've never worked for a union before. I've worked next to unions in the
mm-hmm.
hospitality industry. So is there a key person that, you know, you'd be talking with, or does it?
No, it doesn't. You wouldn't have to worry about, you'd end up joining the union by being hired.
Oh, okay.
I think what Deborah's asking for are benefits.
Well, the benefits.
Well, that would probably come.
Yeah, the benefits
come,
I would contract to.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's, I mean, there are people in the town hall who would, you know, do the, who will do our onboarding.
Mm-hmm.
It's all proofs.
Great.
Well, thank you.
All right,
thanks, everyone. Have a good night. Don't stay too late.
We're trying not to.
Thanks.
Did find out for talked to Sabrina too, that we should probably do some reference checking because they don't do anything.
There's no quarry check even?
I guess we could request.
Okay, but it's not done as a matter of rules and policies?
Actually, I think the law changed on that too, is that originally, when I got hired at the hospital, they quarry checked you prior to being employed.
Yeah.
I think now you get employed and then they quarry check. Because there's usually a 90 days.
According to Sabrina, they don't do anything.
No,
so
they don't.
We want to check references.
We don't have a policy with regard to background checks or quarry that we would be following.
Unless they're working with children.
We just got a job in the Situate High School. Everybody has to be quarry checked prior to.
That's different.
But that's a school.
You're going into work at a school, but you have employees.
Right.
They're just doing a background check on everybody who's employed that's going to be on that site.
Yeah.
The difference about being employed, though, is I think they changed that.
There's no town policy on background checks or quarry? I thought that was part of the theory was that, you know, that the town has the employment policies.
I asked if they check references, and she was like, no.
So we're responsible for checking references.
Yeah.
I don't put a lot of value in references because, like, they're obviously going to put someone down. It's like, going to give them a good, you know, it's just like, what's the point?
This isn't
my son pull on three up on Facebook and see what I get. It's more valuable.
If you ask questions, you may be able to get some good information.
Folks ready for the next one?
Yep.
So once we're done with these interviews, do we discuss this in open session, or do we go into...
No, we have to discuss it, unless there's some particular issue about someone's background or reputation.
I think you probably need to go on executive session.
No, you can't.
Oh, because we didn't put it on there?
No, because there's...
Did you call me Daniel?
If you were talking about a specific contract that you were negotiating, you could go into executive session to talk about, like, you know, the specific terms of the contract that you were negotiating. But when you're hiring, apparently, the only, other than the screening interviews, that could take place in executive session, did take place in executive session. The interviews in the hiring decisions are supposed to be an open session. Unless someone has an issue about someone's character or background or reputation, but then you have to give someone, the person who's the subject of that discussion has to give prior advance notice and an opportunity to attend or not, and bring someone or not. So there's a whole process to that, but I haven't heard that anything has been raised regarding any of the applicants that would trigger that. Yeah.
Excellent. Matthew, welcome back.
Thank you very much.
Hi.
So as you guys can see, if you look at Matthew's resume, it's pretty extensive. A lot of planning background. An associate planner in Georgia.
And a lot of skills around the software that's related to planning. As well as clerical software, like Word and Excel and PowerPoint, Outlook.
Not Outlook so much, but definitely Word, Excel, PowerPoint. I've used all those very extensively.
Right.
And Outlook, I've used a little bit, and I'm sure I could easily pick it up extremely quickly. It's a pretty standard email program. I've used a lot of this. I mean, I'm probably one of the more sort of unusual candidates you would come across, obviously. My career path has you know, not necessarily been what I've, you know, it's gone in different directions. I think a lot of the things I've done, I've benefited from, and, you know, getting a PhD, sort of improves your skills in many different ways and your understanding, I think.
So with the amount of administrative work done for this, I mean, this is a pretty administrative type position. Is that going to be exciting enough for you with a background like this? I mean, you've got extensive background in architecture. You've been a lecturer. You've spent a lot of time in academia, which is great. But you've got a lot of skill sets here that are pretty high up in comparison to what we're, you know, we're requiring for the job.
Yeah, no, it won't be a problem. I mean, you know, most architectural jobs are, is anybody here an architect? Or, mm-hmm. It's not.
Engineer, I know what you want to say.
Yeah, I mean,
I
love architecture, but 95% of it is drafting, which can be tedious in some ways, even if sort of the final result is interesting. So it won't be a problem. I mean, I'm sort of in a somewhat unusual just position. I'm kind of simultaneously sort of overqualified and underqualified maybe for a lot of what I'm applying for, because I have been away from sort of real world employment, so to speak, for a while. But essentially, you know, I've decided, you know, I've been a lecturer, which is basically to say a sort of a part-time adjunct faculty member. And as you probably know, you know, adjuncts are very low paid, and it's become really, unless you have connections or you're sort of a superstar, it's just virtually impossible to get a tenure track position. You know, and having done a PhD, of course, that was my ambition, and then sort of having published some things, I really thought I was doing well in that regard. But it's just become so difficult. And so finally I sort of decided I just, you know, it's time to go back to real world employment. But having been away from it for a while and having kind of done both architecture and planning, I sort of have to start, I wouldn't say at square one exactly, but I sort of have to, you know, go back to that. So that's definitely not a problem for me. I mean, my job for the state of Georgia, a lot of it was administrative and so forth. And so I think that's sort of, you know, a step along the path. And I think as long as sort of what you're doing in the larger picture is of interest to you, you know, the issues and so forth, you know, planning appeals to me a little more than architecture because it is at a larger scale. There's a little more social issues, politics, economics involved, even if it's a, say, a town like Pembroke as opposed to a city like Boston. There's always that larger scale that I think is really fascinating for me.
And what about like grant writing? I mean, one of the things we had talked about at one point was, you know, could we ever get enough funding to have a real planner position versus a clerical position? And right now, it's seen as somewhat far-fetched from a financial standpoint. But we do need to update our master plan, and we do have Old Colony Planning Council who can help us with that. But there are some things where we haven't really taken a look at some of the planning issues in town as much as we might like to. Do you see it within your bailiwick to look for grants that might help fund some additional hours for other people to either come in and help you on the planning side or on the clerical side, so that, you know, maybe fund part of your position through a grant so that then we could use some of the money that's budgeted for someone else? I mean, how do you see that as a possibility?
I'd be delighted to sort of write up grant proposals and funding proposals. I think I could certainly do a very good job on the writing side of those. In terms of my expertise or my knowledge in the world is more sort of coming from academia. You know, I've obviously have applied for some sort of grants and fellowships and so forth as a PhD student. And what you're talking about, I'm sure, would be quite different. So that's not necessarily, you know, those sort of grants are not something I'm sort of highly cognizant of. It's just not something I've done before. Again, within academia, I've done it quite a bit, but not the sort of thing you're talking about, I think. But I think, you know, as far as writing that sort of thing up, that would be well within my skill set. I think that would be something I'd be quite good at.
Would you have an interest in going out and scouring for those kind of opportunities?
Oh, definitely. But I don't necessarily have a background in having done it previously, just so you understand that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I think I could be a person who, you know, could come in and try to be proactive in looking for opportunities or you know, getting advice from all of you and then being able to sort of take the initiative on my own and try to learn about things and look for opportunities and so forth. That would be something that's new to me, but I think that's not a problem.
Can you do anything with heating?
That's an engineer.
I don't know, architects
architects have to know HVAC systems, don't they?
I don't think this qualifies as
HVAC systems.
Use a bigger hammer.
So, I'm talking about that, though. That would be relatively, that'd be in the lower third of the priority list, though.
Yes, it would be wonderful, but yes, it's in the, it's, we need to get our day-to-day work done first. I agree with you.
Right. So the day-to-day work can be, you know, you're prone to interruptions during the day, phones ringing. You never know when, you know, someone out there, a constituent of ours, if you will give you a call asking a question about what may be going on down the block. There's a very significant customer service component to what this position does, because it's really the face of the planning board to the public when they first encounter the planning board. And that goes not only for, you know, the public, but also goes toward the, you know, the developers that may come in, or anyone who's, you know, going to be putting a site plan together with us, or a business owner. So a big component of this is really trying to provide the type of service that would lay the ground rules for them, because they may come in here with not a lot of knowledge on how Pembroke works. So, you know, we're really requiring this position to become pretty quickly, you know, conversant in how Pembroke does things, what our bylaws are. So can you give me an example of another time in maybe your career where you've been put into a situation where you're kind of new, may not know all the rules? How quickly can you get up to date, and what would be the approach to that?
I think to some extent every new job I've had has had some of those. Especially as an adjunct, you're often sort of thrown in and just told, here's the course title, go ahead and write up your syllabus and figure out what it's going to be. So I think that's something I'm comfortable with. In terms of my sort of what my approach would be or my strategy, you know, I think it's important to listen and learn from other people. If possible, to talk to the sort of person who's done the job previously, or talk to other employees within the town of Pembroke, to be able to look at the relevant documents, planning, zoning documents, the regulations, maps, and so forth. But also, just sort of not to be afraid to be proactive and to sort of jump right in, I guess. I think communication, I mean, generally your biggest assets, so to speak, are going to be your coworkers, and so communication is crucial. And then with the general public also, just sort of being able to sort of communicate reliably as well. And so people know that even if you don't have the answer, you'll call them back and tell them how you're progressing or where you stand, so people feel that they rely on you as a consistent person, and they don't get frustrated with sort of a person who kind of drops out of contact, or they don't know where they stand, and that sort of thing. So I think, you know, having taught, I think I mentioned this last time, I was here, just sort of having taught for the past about 2 years now, primarily undergrads, some graduate students also, I think my sort of my communication skills and my sort of interpersonal skills have definitely strengthened in that regard. So yeah, I think the, you know, I mean, I think the certainly the paperwork is crucial to sort of do those things reliably, but the communication at the end of the day is, I would imagine, the most important. And I'm sure both sort of by phone and by email, sort of both critical to sort of communicate carefully and be aware that everything you say, you know, sort of for better or for worse, everything you say is sort of on the record, and you're sort of responsible for those things.
Have you had another time where you've had to learn bylaws or regulations?
I haven't, because my previous job in planning was for the state of Georgia. So that was more of, we would basically review, well, we had a number of things we did, but we would, one crucial thing is we would review all the comprehensive plans that were submitted by local governments throughout the state. This was when I was in Atlanta. And also we'd sort of promote quality growth and good practices. We would travel around the state, sort of having charrettes and other things, talking about different problems, you know, in different parts of Georgia. So that's something I'm definitely familiar with, but I haven't previously worked in a local government or in a planning capacity at the local level.
What was the criteria for reviewing the comprehensive plans? Was it just sort of friendly advice, or did you have a statutory role in the review?
It was statutory. In practice, generally, we were kind of expected not to really raise a fuss unless there's a serious problem with the plan. You know, we definitely got some plans that we thought could have been better, had certain issues, but, you know, we generally maybe just approve them anyway. But if there were certain problems, especially with the current land use map and the future land use map that they are required to submit. And so those, if there were problems with those, if there are inconsistencies or things that could be legal issues, we would have to say, okay, this is an issue. And then there are just sort of certain sections of the plans that had to be submitted. There are also things called service delivery strategies, which were for infrastructure, which in Georgia, there's a lot of, obviously it's very different from here, so there's lots of issues with annexations, municipalities annexing and extending out into unincorporated parts of the county. And so often the different local governments are competing with their water and sewer lines, actually. Sometimes it'll be a city versus county or a city versus other city. And so they'd have to submit these documents, which we would check to make sure nobody was overlapping, you know, no sort of wasteful duplication of services and so on. Primarily it was water and sewer, there could be other issues as well. And so those sorts of things, again, sort of a statutory role where we would, you know, just have to, at a basic level, just have to make sure there weren't conflicts and overlaps and so on.
Finish.
I was going to say, so, I mean, one of the big things we have to do is keep track of timelines. Yeah. So how would you go about, you know, if we have five site plans, if we don't respond to them within a certain amount of time, they become automatically accepted. We have subdivision plans that expire after a certain period of time, although there's a question as to whether it's our obligation or the developer's obligation to watch the clock on those. What would sort of be your strategy for learning in watching those sort of things to help the board make sure we don't mess up on those kind of things?
I think I'm a pretty well-organized person, I can honestly say that. And so I think, you know, have everything laid out either with Excel spreadsheets or other sort of graphical things, and just sort of keep everybody in constant communication, probably through CC emails, I'd imagine, just to make sure we're all on the same page and sort of saying clearly, this is where we stand right now, here's what's coming up imminently, here's what's further on the horizon. And to really sort of be on top of those things on a day-to-day level and not to let things sort of just kind of slip out of sight or get lost in the shuffle, to make sure everything is organized in a very clear way. Really just to stay on top of things and not to let one project sort of become so stressful or sort of take up so much of my time that I'm losing track of other things. Like not to panic about one thing and say, oh, you know, the next 3 days we're only going to do this, and then that's when other things start to sort of maybe slip away. So to be, I think, efficient at multitasking and really sort of make sure that you're on top of all.
So I kind of like where you're going with this as far as the, you know, not panicking over things. So.
Or hopefully not.
Yeah, sure.
I can't promise.
People are human. You know, we like to talk a lot about competencies, behaviors, and, you know, the big buzzword now is emotional intelligence. You know, kind of understanding that there are times when you need to kind of keep calm in the face of adversity, if you will. So is there an example you can bring us from maybe your career where, you know, there was some stress happening in a project, maybe a timeline that was pretty tight, or a couple of people asking for your time all at the same time, or things all kind of falling into place, you know, in a kind of a short timeline? Were you, how did you kind of handle that, or what kind of ways did you use to, skills did you use, or behaviors did you use to kind of manage that?
I think maybe being a PhD student was maybe the sort of the best example of that, even though it's not a real-world job, so to speak, just because you've got, on the one hand, you're expected to make progress on your dissertation, and then you have to sort of keep up with your classes. You're a teaching assistant, and then later on, I actually taught a class too. And so you're kind of wearing a lot of different hats, and you really have to make sure all those things are, you know, it's up to you at the end of the day. You have to just make sure you're being responsible to all those different people who have expectations, whether it's your students, whether it's the faculty, people, the class you're taking, or the dissertation that you're working on. It's sort of the onus is on you to make sure you're or the onus was on me to make sure I was keeping track of all those obligations I had. And I think just, you know, sometimes just really taking it one step at a time. And once, you know, if you're carefully well organized, then at least you know, then at least you sort of can keep track of everything. You know where you stand. And if you do fall behind, at least you know exactly where you stand on everything. And at least you can kind of prioritize and say, this is crucial. You know, this can wait till tomorrow. This is a deadline in 2 hours. And once you, I feel like once you're well organized, then at least you can, then at least you can take it one thing at a time without stressing about those other things.
So what about strategies to organization and prioritization? Any kind of strategies that you use to kind of get yourself in a position where you feel very confident about, you know, the timelines and everything else?
I think just sort of, based on what your coworkers tell you or what deadlines you know are coming up, what you've learned from experience, to sort of prioritize more important than other things. And to, again, to make sure that you're well organized enough that you don't spend an entire, maybe 8 hours a day on one thing and lose track of those other things, or maybe just that 10 minutes, just putting that 10 minutes into something sort of keeps you on track, that one phone call or something. But if you're so, you know, if you don't see that thing. So for me, just trying to stay calm and definitely keeping track of what the deadlines are. And also kind of, sort of what you said, emotional intelligence, paying attention to people, whether it's all of you, of course, or my coworkers or a developer or whatever, and understanding what things are crucial to people and what things are important but less, you know, less imminent or less essential.
It's not an easy job because you've got to manage the expectations of the board, you've got to manage the expectations of town hall, you've got to manage the expectations of the public. So the next question I was going to ask you was on prioritization. It may not be a fair question, so don't feel too much pressure, but you know what, if someone else's priorities aren't the same as yours, but you really know what the priority is, right? I mean, you've got a timeline, you've got a project that needs to be completed on time, or at least the process needs to continue, and someone else can come in and completely throw you a curveball on that. But their priorities, of course, would be way above where they, you know, where reality is with a priority. So handling that, so that could be something like a, you know, a citizen coming in and saying they're doing something down the block, you guys need to do something about it, you know, that kind of thing.
Well, I guess I should back up. I've been in, even though I work for the state of Georgia, I've been in enough sort of local government sort of zoning meetings and that kind of thing to know how contentious they can be. And so I think it is important sometimes to kind of let a lot of that stress, or the stress other people are feeling, or the intensity of their emotions, or the intensity of their criticism, to just sort of take it with a grain of salt and let it, you know, be the adult in the room, in a sense, and kind of let it, you know, don't take it personally, just kind of let it go and you know, take it in a mature way. I think in terms of your question, my ultimate responsibility would be to all of you, the board, and then also to the town. Is the town manager, is that the right title?
Which is a big difference in Massachusetts.
You have no mayor, right? It's just
we have no mayor. Right. We have the board of selectmen who manages the town administrator.
But we're an autonomous board.
So my primary sort of loyalty or obligation, so to speak, would be to the priorities that all of you give me, or at least I would imagine, and then also, I assume, to the town administrator.
There wouldn't be many cases where that would happen.
Obviously we're professionals, and we work with other boards professionally.
Yeah.
So to the extent the Board of Selectmen, who are the governing executive function in town, have a question of us or have we need to collaborate with them, it's important to be professional and respectful with that department. But in terms of the actual priority and supervision,
and the work, it
normally goes through the board.
Yeah.
And there are definitely, again, back to what you're talking about, there would definitely be times where I have to sort of, maybe politely but firmly, say to that member of the public or that abutter, that stakeholder, that developer, whatever. I hear what you're saying, but that's going to come up next Wednesday, or that's, you know, I can get back to you by next Friday on that, but I can't do that now. Or maybe, you know, in some way or other, again, to sort of try to be the adult in the room, so to speak, but not to be sort of, not to let somebody else's emergency become my emergency, unless it's clearly something that all of you would regard in that fashion.
Just one question. Why Pembroke? What made you decide you wanted to join up one of the town?
Well, again, I'm sort of having decided to leave academia. I do want to stay. So I'm originally from, I grew up in Newton, you know, a suburb obviously much larger and closer to Boston, but somewhat similar maybe. And, you know, I have my father and stepmother are still in the Boston area. My mother is in New York, so not too far away. And I decided that, you know, it made sense to, I mean, my parents are getting older, and it just seemed like it made sense to be back here in Massachusetts permanently. So at that point, just looking for jobs in urban planning, really all sort of throughout eastern Massachusetts, Boston, suburban areas and so forth, even a few in Rhode Island. And so Pembroke was one of the ones that there. So I before I applied here, I'd never been to Pembroke before. I had heard of Pembroke, but I certainly can't claim I had any special knowledge or interest in Pembroke before that. But I think definitely, you know, when I was working in Georgia, you know, every town, you know, whether it was, you know, Atlanta or a small town in the countryside or something in between, there was always some interesting issue or some interesting problem happening. And sometimes being in a small or medium-sized town is even more interesting because you can sort of understand the whole thing, whereas if you're working for the city of Boston, you might just be sort of a tiny piece in a gigantic puzzle.
I know that in your time at the Georgia Department of Community Affairs, you worked for 2 years, then you worked, it looks like, 2 summers.
Yeah, that's while I was, that's while I was a PhD student.
Oh, okay.
And so they had me come back for 2 summers to work.
Okay.
And in retrospect, actually, I probably should have been working on the dissertation or doing some, being smart about progressing my academic career. But yeah, that's what
makes sense.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And are you going to move to Boston? Are you
going
to move to Pembroke?
I would definitely move down here. I'm definitely not a fan of a long commute. done it today. And also just I would want to be, you know, either in Pembroke or near Pembroke, just kind of to be rooted in the place where I am so that I sort of know what's going on here and so forth, yeah, and get a sense of what the community is like. Yeah. And also, of course, just... Well, yeah, the housing. I'm sure the housing would be more affordable around here as well. But I mean, it's just incredible what's happened in the Boston area.
Oh, yeah.
It's just amazing.
Okay.
I would just state that this is primarily, and I know you, to me, you have a lot of education, but this is primarily a clerical position, and there's really no. Your co-workers are yourself, in a way, in this office.
That's kind of what Becky was saying. It's more of a department head position because you don't have...
Well, of course, but we do. But that's not how it went out. But, I mean, basically it's a union position, which has, and I brought up to the last person, is that sometimes, even though there's not really a time frame for work, like on a Monday night like tonight, this meeting, or a general meeting with developers and things like that, can go much longer than, let's say, from 7 to 9. Some of these offices close, this place right now is empty, we're the last department here. So some, in the 18 years I've been here, we've had meetings up to sometimes 11 o'clock in June, can vouch for that.
And those are Monday nights.
Those are Monday nights. Now, normally we meet every other Monday night, but we have for years we've met almost every Monday night, depending on how the workload comes in, because we are on a time sensitive requirements by the state to meet those requirements of the applicants, whether it's public hearings, notices, and so, and sometimes what mostly happens would be on that government would be to move the meetings along to meet those requirements of open public hearings, and to make sure that the chairman understands that, and we may have to stop right now to open another hearing, to close a hearing, to then to make a continuance, and then to control the minutes of meetings. It would be in the, your, that application's your responsibility. Then we have site walks sometimes to go out and see the sites to give a visual of what we need or what we're talking about. And then the other thing that didn't come up the last one, because I didn't even think about it, was at town meetings. When we have articles on town meeting, it would be required to be there to make sure that we have what we need for that particular meeting with the town, whether it's to a change in zoning, you know, anything that we had to do, whether it's land acquisitions or things that part of this board may be moving, or even road acceptance, things like that, town meeting. So those are part of those jobs.
Yeah, the Monday night's not a problem. That was mentioned in the details of the job posting and stuff, so that's not a problem. And if there's a need for me to work on weekends, I forget if that was
Sometimes on Saturday.
Yeah, that's
very good. Maybe a Saturday, sometimes for a site visitor based on
availability of applicant.
I think my architectural background could help a little bit with some of the site visits, or just in terms of reading site plans and looking into some of those sort of things as well, that sort of level of familiarity. But yeah, that's all that stuff is not a problem.
Okay.
And yeah, in terms of sort of working here, whatever sort of the extent of whatever interfacing I need to do with other coworkers, whether it's a little bit or a lot or none at all, I think I can sort of handle those situations.
Okay.
Yeah. You do have a department of planning and zoning, is that right?
This is it.
No, this is it. So the planning, so the way it works.
I mean, it's listed on the.
Don't believe what you read.
So the way it works is that the planning board is an independent board that is responsible for planning board functions, legal functions of the planning board. The zoning board of appeals and the building department both share, the building inspector is the zoning enforcement officer.
Okay.
And the zoning, board of appeals is also housed in that office.
Okay.
The zoning board of appeals is actually appointed by the board of selectmen, and the building inspector is reports up to the town administrator and thereby to the board of selectmen. So the zoning board of appeals and the building inspector inspectional departments are a complementary entity, but we're sort of, we have somewhat separate legal functions and somewhat separate legal housing.
We actually come up with the zoning rules.
And then they
enforce them.
Yeah,
well, sometimes they try.
How often do appeals go to them?
All the time.
Okay.
Very common.
So we're probably going to move along though.
Yeah. So there are things when the ZBA has their findings, generally we get a copy of them.
Okay.
We probably could do a somewhat better job of following what's going on over there so that we don't get surprised at the last minute.
Well,
we recently had an issue where we sort of realized very late in the process that there was a decision made that we thought was not in keeping with the town bylaws, that it weren't decisions that the ZBA should have made.
Right.
So it turned into litigation that maybe we could have headed off.
Here's what happened. No, I don't think so. What happens though is we get the copy of that in our packet. Every week we get a copy from the ZBA.
We do.
It's up to the board to take and go through that and take and pick it up.
However,
it would be nice.
However, that one was filed pretty late with the clerk.
Well, that's true.
Almost at the end of the appeal, you know,
process.
Yeah, but I don't think it goes to. I don't think they get. I think they have to go and get it stamped.
Yeah.
Before the clock stops.
All I'm saying is that sometimes we could. It would be helpful if maybe our clerk helped us stay on top of that stuff.
Right, but they have to write the decision too. So until it comes out in print,
it's hard for us to know.
It's not a decision.
We get them all.
Right, we get them.
Oh, I know I get them, but I don't always notice the significance.
Yeah, we get them.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll hopefully let everybody know soon.
Yes.
What's your sort of timeline, more or less?
I think we're hoping to make a decision tonight or next week and let everybody know where we're at.
In your availability, if it comes to that?
I guess immediately. definitely let me know. But yeah, I'm pretty much available. Whatever you prefer.
Okay.
I'm obviously living in Boston now, so there might be a certain amount of commuting for the first few weeks or something like that. But yeah, I'm pretty much available.
Okay. Yeah.
And just sort of stay in touch so I have an idea of what the situation is in there.
Okay, great.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a great night.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, take care.
Have a good night.
Good night.
Rachel's here. Come on up, Rachel.
So it's the end of Tom Show.
Well, no, I still want to make sure that she understands. I still want to put some clarification on some of the things that we do or are required for this board, as far as there's discussions about like Monday nights that we meet, and that the hours are not necessarily set like the rest of the town. Well, it's sort of like a CPC meeting where it can go longer than a defined end. And then the question is that normally we meet every other, but for a lot of times we meet every Monday night because of just the workload and the time-sensitive requirements by the state to meet and to take action on certain things, whether it's public hearings, whether it's the approvals and whatever restrictions we have on a site plan or on a subdivision. Then there's also, we do site walks that can occur on it. And basically, a lot of times it's up to the board when they can meet, whether it's a Saturday or a Sunday morning, something that works out for you, for the person's position, or for the board in general, works and work out best for that site walk and the developer. Then there's also, and I just brought up about town meeting. A lot of times we have articles on town meeting, and we kind of want to make sure that we have everything there to present to the town. And that's part of what we've done in the past. The only thing that's different about this versus with Marilyn is that this position is going to be a union position. And that's sort of the preference of the selectmen, not necessarily the preference of the board, but we'll work through it. And not to say that we're against that, but I'm just saying is that it opens up a fine line as to how many hours and compensation and things like that, and that'll be worked out over the course of time. I think we'll have to adjust to that. But otherwise, I'm already familiar with you, so I'll open it up to the other two.
As it stands right now, you work Project CPC.
Yes.
If you have time to plan it out.
I'm actually hired as an independent contractor.
Okay. This will give you a deal.
Yes.
Why are you changing seats?
Sorry.
Why are you going from CPC to planning? Is the CPC a full-time job?
No, it's very part-time.
Okay, I understand.
And she doesn't have to actually probably give that up?
No, she won't, no.
Not necessarily, I don't think, unless it, unless it, we can flex.
We can
talk about that right now.
We don't know what the rules are.
Yeah, we don't know the rules about conflicts and whether or not you can.
Well, see, that may be one of those things you have to talk about in executive session.
No, that's, no, I mean, I think that'll be up to her, but there'll be an answer.
Right, okay.
And I thought that there's a whole issue about whether you're a special municipal employee versus a municipal employee, whether you can have multiple jobs.
Yeah, I don't know, but anyway, so that'll be another discussion on something.
Another issue. I'm sure that they, you know, that Jim and Becky and Dan explained your position, what you have to do. Which probably is quite similar to what you do for CPC.
Some of it is, yes.
I think the only other thing that is going to be different is going to be the actually clocking in the stuff that comes in and making sure that it's documented, that everything is time sensitive. I mean, I'm sure you're proficient with, like I said, you're proficient with Microsoft, Excel, and Word.
Yes.
That's basically what we use. I don't have any other questions.
Well, what would your strategy be for maintaining a sort of view of all of the projects that are pending, all of the site plans, all of the subdivision plans, and all the deadlines that we have to follow here in town?
I'm glad you asked that question, because that was something that I was responsible for when I worked over at Massasoit as the assistant to the executive director of communications there. And actually, I had an Excel because she was, that was her main reason for trying to find somebody, to hire somebody. She had never had an assistant before, and she wanted somebody to kind of keep her on track. She was having difficulty doing that, meeting deadlines and things like that. So actually, I used a simple Excel file where we had a lot of things due at the same time every year, over and over again. For instance, our college view book and things like that. So I really just had a simple Excel spreadsheet that would remind me, and it would, I had a tie-in to my Outlook account that would send me reminders and things like that, so that I was always on top of what was coming up next.
Good. That sounds like a strategy. So you've got some great experience in customer service based on what you've done in the past.
Absolutely, you know, yes.
The legislative aid requires a lot of interaction with the public. So from your experience, and I'm sure you've seen the gamut from people very happy to people very upset.
Absolutely.
So give us an example of a time when someone may have been pretty upset and how you kind of steered the conversation back to kind of calmness, or got them an answer that they were may not have been happy with, but were satisfied enough with.
Sure. Actually, it is, I think back to when I was a legislative aide, during the time that I was at the State House as an aide, we had a lot of phone calls from constituents who were having difficulties finding employment and were therefore signing up for financial assistance through the state. And they were very upset, naturally, because some of them were in jeopardy of losing their homes. And so they would call us looking for assistance and answers, and they were very upset. And the way that it's difficult sometimes to explain and put into words, but the way that I would deal with them and their situation was I always tried to be, also obviously compassionate, but I tried to relate to them and try to understand what they were going through to try to help get them in a situation where they could, in a mind frame, sorry, where they could try to deal with things, think through things rather than use emotion. And I just, in my own life experience, I think I've related to so many different experiences like that, and people and their life experiences, that it makes it easy for me to talk to just about anyone. And so I don't find that difficult. when people come at me with emotion, I'm able to take a step back, take a deep breath, and kind of look at all the options and solutions.
So when you were thinking about this position, what kind of research did you do to find out more about it?
I mainly just read the job description, and I went to your webpage. I looked at what you have there for your documentation of meetings and things like that. And then I went online to actually get just a basic definition and explanation of what a planning board is and the different things that it's responsible for.
Tell us what a planning board is.
Tom still doesn't know.
I'm on the
Tom still doesn't know what our duties are, what our obligations are. That's good. That's good. Did you find out anything that you weren't expecting?
Not really, except I do have a question. I heard you earlier mention about the legality of the board. There was something in the description that I read online that there was that you pretty much take votes, and that sets the policy and sort of sets up what goes before the town, like that. But then there was another aspect of it. They said that the planning board has two functions, and it's not really just legislative in nature. Is that
so? So we do. I'd say we have two main functions in this town, and it can vary from town to town. We work on bylaw changes and bylaw review, so that's more of the kind of, and that has to go before town meeting. So if we want to change a bylaw, we would prepare it. There'd be some coordination with town council, and there would be a presentation of some kind at town meeting to get a vote, because it can only be changed at town meeting.
And zoning, too.
Yeah.
Right.
So whether that's a zoning.
We write the zoning bylaws,
that's what I meant, really. Right. But the other piece of it is, most of what we do week to week is really reviewing site plans and issuing special permits in certain parts of town, issuing site plan reviews in other site parts of town, reviewing subdivision plans, and hopefully trying to engage in some amount of planning, reviewing the maps and keeping those up to date. And at some point we need to update our master plan, whether we do that through Old Colony Planning Council, whether we find a grant to hire someone to come in and help us do that. That's also within our bailiwick, is to help to create a master plan and go through the master planning process, which involves other people as well.
Well, we had the last time we did it, we had a committee was appointed by this board to take up, basically, we took the money, put out flyers, things like that, asked the public what they thought the town needed, and then they compiled all that, brought it to this board, where we looked at it and made decisions based on that.
Yeah, there were several bylaw changes made as a result.
To finish your question, we're also regulatory,
right,
in that we set the standards, construction standards for new roadways, like how wide they have to be, how much pavement, where the trees have to go, stuff like that.
Okay.
So that's the regulatory part.
Okay. Gotcha.
Well, and even in sort of a regulatory judicial part in terms of our review.
Yeah.
So there's a lot we do that we don't even.
No,
we just do it.
The other piece that I think we've talked about when you came before the subcommittee were grants, and sort of looking for grants to fund things like a master plan, or to help fund maybe a part-time planner position, or to, you know, do some of the other work that we're looking at in terms of grant-based work that might help some of what we do. And your experience in looking for grants and finding grants and helping to write grant applications.
It could be for funding, things like that, as the board comes up with. We want to put on a town meeting, for a town meeting vote to come up with $50,000 for a new, and then it's a question of getting that up to the selectmen just like any other article that's put on town meeting.
But I'm also talking about grants, where we go out and look for grants.
No, I understand that, but I'm talking about things we've actually done here.
Right, well, I'm asking...
These might be new things that...
Yes, I'm asking whether or not we... I'm asking what, in terms of capabilities of going out and looking for grants to maybe improve some of what we do here.
I do have some experience with that, which I acquired while working as a legislative aide as well at the State House. I did only work there for a year, so it's just a year of that experience, but I do have...
I think you had talked about actually going out and looking for grants
yes.
for the towns that were
yes.
within your district.
Yes.
Maybe you want to elaborate on that a little bit more.
Well, the one that comes to mind right away, probably because it was the most fun to find, was when actually a constituent here in Pembroke called us looking for funding for a skateboard park.
That's been going on.
Oh, I remember that.
Yeah.
And we actually found one right through Tony Hawk. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. And we got the grant for him. So it was exciting. But there are so many other avenues that we could explore for grants for the town. So we'd be happy to
try to track them down.
Absolutely.
Any other questions? Any questions? More questions for us?
Okay, Rachel, I'm going to bring this up to you because I brought it up to one of the other applicants. I didn't get a lot into the room. We have some free time.
Again.
About the chalkboard.
Oh, I already heard about the chalkboard.
No, this is a different perspective on the chalkboard.
Okay.
I don't particularly want it wiped out.
Okay.
All right. Some people want it wiped out.
Okay.
No, I look at it as a tool.
Yeah, I just heard that it hasn't changed.
It's an older version of a spreadsheet.
Right. It is an older version of a spreadsheet, but it's one that when we're in meetings sometimes, sometimes when you're in a meeting, you're not really looking at things. But things come up, and we're talking about this board. And I yes, it can be utilized better than it is.
Sure.
And whether it's modified in the future or removed or whatever, but I do think that a visual sometimes...
Sure, give off great heat.
Yeah, I don't think so. But realistically, sitting on this side of that, I use that quite a bit to look at things that actually haven't been completed, haven't been off that board, that exist. And sometimes when we're looking quickly about somebody coming in and wanting an extension of time, there's a perfect example of things that constantly are in here for extensions of time, that you're not having to go to a computer or a spreadsheet, or maybe you haven't... You didn't have the time to slip that out and sit like that.
I heard about a strategy of using Excel to kind of manage and prioritize.
Well, that's true.
Sounds really good to me.
Could you translate your Excel spreadsheet onto a board like this?
I don't have you. Should just take the spreadsheet.
I'm just saying that for a site, sometimes what happens in that's what we always used. I'm not saying it has to go away. I'm not saying it can't go away. All I'm saying is that it's a tool that has been used in the past and has been used pretty effectively for people who come in and they haven't finished something.
So that leads me to a good question, because Paul obviously has a need for that, and the rest of us don't.
What about when there's conflict among board members?
What we could do is weekly email, have a spreadsheet email to us showing us where we are.
Yeah, but I don't do email.
Oh, you should.
Yeah. Okay. So that's a good. That leads to my question. So we've got a board of seven members. Some want a more technology presented to them. Not really technology, but they want an easier way to kind of access information. Others want access to the information in different ways. So how do you kind of manage that and strategize around that?
Well, I've actually had to deal with that with the CPC.
Obviously.
They prefer to have things like minutes, notifications, and things like that mailed to their home, at the post office, and there are others who prefer an email. And I'm happy to do whatever the board prefers, whatever makes everyone happy, I will do it. So I go to the post office and I send an email to the CPC. So that's what I would do here as well.
So speaking of keeping everyone happy, what do you do when you have multiple things on your plate and someone comes in with a major complaint? How do you handle your day? How do you handle that interaction?
You mean someone, it could be...
From the public says, you know, I just got this notice in the mail and there's a public hearing and I want to know more about this because it's right down the street from my house and I think it's going to be a huge problem. And they, you know, and that becomes... Well, no, okay, I'm not asking how you would handle it, Jim, I know how you would handle it.
That's why he doesn't deal with the public.
You're not allowed to deal with the public. How would you handle it?
Well, I think at the beginning, I'm sure there would be a learning curve to know what, you know, exactly which would be the priority. I think after some time, once I learned that, you know, if the constituent is my priority at that moment in time, that's what would have to take precedence at that moment in time. But I think it would, you know, take me. I can't put a timeline on it, but it would take me a reasonable amount of time to know what the board sees as the priorities.
Well, I mean, what if the priority was that you had to get a notice out to the newspapers and to all the abutters for a public meeting that we had scheduled and someone comes in with a constituent complaint and we're on a legal clock
Sure.
on the notices to the abutters and about the public hearing?
I think naturally, off the top of my head here, I would say... naturally, I would try to get the legal notice completed immediately and then try to deal with the constituent. I mean, if we were going to miss a deadline, naturally, I wouldn't want to have that happen. And I would try to explain to the constituent, this is the situation. I would, of course, invite them to stay or here.
That's actually very easy. You just put a sign on the door that says, gone to the bathroom. Go to the bathroom. Email a newspaper from your smartphone to say, put in the following notice.
Well, no, but I do think that there's a piece of the job that's not easy, and that is that sometimes you can't allow yourself to be kind of whipsawed with your priorities because there are things that come at you.
Okay.
And there are other people's priorities as opposed to the priorities of the office. And that sometimes when you're in that constituent role, I do think that's a difficult thing because we are, you know, we do serve the public and the developers are part of the public that needs to utilize our services. At the same time, we have things that are on the agenda already that are ahead of this person who just came in the door. And so it's, you know, you don't want to lose track of servicing the person whose notice needs to go out or else it messes up their schedule. At the same time, you have someone come in the office and keeping that from overtaking your day sometimes can be a challenge. So being able to kind of allow someone to be heard but not allow them to take over your day can be difficult.
Sure.
I would say in this chair.
I was going to say, too, sometimes we get... There's a lot of stuff that really isn't in our bailiwick, if you will, that gets presented us to go on the agenda, and, you know, disputes between neighbors, you know, easements that were between a developer and a butter, you know, that they'll try to kind of come back here and look for some kind of resolution, and we're really not, I think that's more next door than...
A lot of times it's a legal issue.
Yeah, sometimes it's just a civil legal issue.
Right.
Yeah.
It's not a town issue.
Sometimes it may be just a question of saying, I'll present your complaint to the board, and we'll get back to you. Some of it can be that simple, that first off, I in your position can't make decisions for the board, and that the board meets on a certain date, and sometimes, and I'll put your question to the board during discussion. That's the calmest way to take, I think, to deal with the public.
In a 10-minute period,
right.
You could
diffuse the issue.
Diffuse the issue and get back to each other.
Right.
I think, you know, being polite and professional and courteous is the key.
Right. And letting them understand that there's nothing that in the discussion that we're having right now that can be solved without the board solving it. At least interjecting their opinion into it. Or whether it goes to a legal issue, because sometimes, a lot of times, we have to seek counsel. I mean, some of the questions that come aren't necessarily something that this board actually can handle. And we need guidance, too. So.
And sometimes it's a question of it's going to take you time to research through the files to find a plan
right.
that someone wants to look at.
Right.
And they're
you
trying...
You discover they're not all here.
And so sometimes finding the plan can take time, and so sometimes it is a question of, you know, this is a realtor who wants to see the plan, but at the same time, you have a, you know, it's not always the easiest position in that sense, and sometimes it's to be firm and say, I'm sorry, but I don't have time to research that today. I'll need to get back to you by X amount of time, depending on how long and what else you have on your plate.
I think it's all doable. Course of a day, sometimes, depending on what the day is.
And depending on where that
Monday's
plan
a tough
is.
Plan. Correct. It could be here, it could be over there, it could be in the trash. Hopefully not. But then again, there's all, you know, and sometimes is that we also, this board deals with the engineering firm that we have on, that we use through subdivisions for reviews and site plans, and so that's another avenue of the ability sometimes to get information.
Speaking of that, we're way over on reviewing, bidding out our peer review people.
Yeah, but that's one of those other things that can be looked at for information that we may not find here. They should have it on their computer system.
Me too.
All right. Thank you very much. Any last questions?
Availability. We've been asking everyone what your availability would be if you were offered the job.
I could start immediately.
All right.
Thank you. Take a break.
Yeah.
I can't believe you guys have a problem with that board.
Thanks again. Nice to see you again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. You too. Thank you very much.
So we'll want to take a 5-minute recess.
Yep. Yeah. A little bathroom break.
Thank you.
Pauses.
You to be this age.
And you too, Dan. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thanks
have
for coming
night.
In. All right. You too.
There's no.
Do you want me to pause that?
Yes. It might be one of the. Might be one of the. What's that?
Do you want me to pause the...
No, you could, yeah.
I don't know if he wants to record our break.
Do you keep the break on record?
Set this hell being recorded.
We have exactly 5 minutes.
have a lunch, huh? Tomorrow.
Everyone's up.
You missed your employer was in the other night.
Employer? Oh,
yeah.
Who's he?
Cumberland.
Oh.
Excuse me.
Okay, so we're back. It's 8:35. We're back from our break. All right, folks. So, how do you want to do this?
Well, should we take them in order?
Me, Dan, and Becky already kind of talked about it. At our executive session, which we're allowed to do.
We were in the subcommittee, so we had to decide who to bring up to you guys.
So, just, I guess I'd like to hear from Andy, Paul, and Tom what you guys think.
Well, personally, I like the idea of having a local person at the position, and that would be Ms. Michael. She seems quite qualified. Mr. Hines, I think he's mostly overqualified. And as far as Mrs. Burns, I think she's probably as qualified as Rachel. So I don't know, guys.
Well, all three candidates bring some great things to the table.
Oh, they do.
You know, I think Rachel's got some local experience, which is great. Although I wanted to ask the question of Matthew whether this would be, kind of a boring type of job for him. But, he answered the questions pretty well. He understood the fact that, the priorities come from the board. They got that pretty quickly. He seems to understand, how to kind of juggle some of the things that are nice to do versus the things that we have to do. The idea of doing some planning, which may be something that's, in a strong set of skills, I think he realizes that that's not going to be the top priority of what he does every day. He's going to have to deal with the public, he's going to have to deal with the board, work with the board. So I like that in his answers. I like what Rachel brings to the table as far as organization and strategy to kind of organize the work. I think both of those candidates got a pretty good handle on what the scope of work is. I didn't get as much of that from our first candidate tonight. Mm-hmm. Her background's pretty different. Not that those skills couldn't come along. Sometimes it's advantageous to come from something completely different to something new, but you bring great skills with you. Mm-hmm. I think she's had some experience dealing with people and customers. However, I think the answers that the other two candidates So I think it's, to me, there's a lot that, Matthew can bring to the table in addition to, the basics of the job, which is appealing. On the other hand, I think Rachel's got great experience. I mean, being a legislative aide means constituent services and understanding how to prioritize some of those things. She has some pretty good answers on the grant process, too, which is something that we're interested in. So. think they're two strong candidates.
Yeah, well, I'll let you guys.
All right, so I thought all the candidates were very good. Reading their
resumes.
I would be concerned if Matthew was hired, I'll be honest with you, because I think one of the problems the board has is that you need to have somebody who's going to be here in this situation for a long time. I think the problem is that because of his education and because of his qualifications to many different things, not necessarily this, I don't think this is going to be enough for him. And when you start having to take and factor in him moving closer, and then he's not from this area, and I'm not sure the money is going to be enough to take and support that commitment. I do agree, and I've dealt with, and I'm being out in the open, is that Rachel works up at the CPC and does a very good job. She is local, and I know that I'm looking for somebody who is going to be committed to the town of Pembroke for a long period of time. And I don't want to have somebody come in and then this board have to go through something in a short period of time to take and we go through this requirement of applying for.
I see your point, but I think you got to look at any candidate that we hire coming even a year.
No, I understand. I understand that, but most people are more inclined if they actually live here and have a family here. They've already set up roots here. You know, to me, it's an enhancement to have somebody that lives in the town of Pembroke already. But that's just my opinion.
I'm sorry. Thank you. I concur with Paul. I felt that Matthew, while he's very qualified, this position does not require a PhD, which he is. And also, looking at his experience, moving through the years, he doesn't stay in many places very long. And it just concerned me that he had a PhD, he's an educator, and I was just sort of surprised that he had some experience in planning, which was good.
If you look at Rachel's, you'll see that she hasn't stayed anywhere very long either.
No.
I guess my concern is that we're making
that
a lot of assumptions.
Yeah. I think the other night Matthew would answer that question, because that was my concern with him. I said, you know, it looks like there's some gaps and stuff in your work. And it was actually, he was either doing his PhD or he was teaching.
Yeah,
and that's why it didn't all like
that.
Flow.
He had said that too.
Well, also, I think that part of the problem, part of the reason why he's looking to settle down is because the way universities these days treat lecturers and adjunct professors is really quite horrible. What they do is that they sign you to a contract for a semester at a time, and you have no job security.
That's what happened with him. I understand that.
And so I felt like he was very clear that he's looking to settle down and make the move, which is a big commitment to make a move like that. And I felt that showed a lot of commitment to this position, that he wasn't going to sort of commute here for as long as he had the job and then find a job somewhere else, right? That he was actually looking to relocate down here. I guess there's a part of me that hears what you're saying about the qualifications go far beyond what we asked for the job. But I think he also could bring a lot to the job that no one else really can because of those qualifications. I feel like he has the ability to help us upgrade our technology in terms of how we manage site plans, how we manage you know, the keeping of records. A lot of this, I think, he has the ability to upgrade at the same time that he could.
So elaborate a little bit on that for us, because not having the benefit of the other meeting, we didn't get too deeply into that question with him. So
sure. He's sent his resume that the software that Merrill uses to produce these maps, he knows it. He can do the same thing with these maps that I could do, bring in GIS maps from the state that are already there. Stuff like that. Like those maps I printed out you for you the other night.
Yeah.
You'd be able to, you know, throw them up on the screen here or something like that. Yeah, that's, and that he was the only one of the three that brought that kind of understanding
technical
of the technology available.
We understand that he is the only one of the three candidates that has any planning experience, which obviously the GIS is part of that job.
Right.
Well, and he also has the architectural experience, so in terms of reviewing site plans and understanding site plans.
He can look at a plan and know what he's looking at.
Architects don't look at site plans, architects don't look at building plans.
Sometimes they do.
They sometimes look at site plans.
I know.
You may think they're not very good at it.
I know they're not very good at it.
But he has the combination of the planning and architect, which is unusual.
Just because you can't build a town doesn't mean it's not a pretty plan.
And I also thought that he made a good point about the fact that when you're doing something like architecture, 95% of it is very detailed, laborious, tedious
work.
Get
into a lot of stuff like how many tiles on the ceiling and how many square foot of paint and how many.
So compared to that, doing letters and doing newspaper notices is like high level.
His teaching and his stuff that he's done, you know, assisting, gives him that clerical piece, you know.
Yeah, but I just feel that he's grossly overqualified, though, Dan.
So what's the problem with someone being overqualified?
I don't think he's going to stay.
I agree.
Right. So the issue with being overqualified is that we don't think he's going to stay. But there's no.
I think he's going to be underpaid for his education. And I think that
he's already done that for years.
In a short period of time with this being in a clerical union has a limited upside.
I don't think so. We can ask people.
Well, we're the ones that have gone backwards from agent to clerical.
Well, I thought we're still looking for an agent.
I think we're looking for someone who can play both roles.
You can look for a town planner, but you've got X amount of dollars to spend. Because what we're getting is a union position with X amount of dollars.
Yeah.
And my point is that his education, very short period of time, it may be a year, it may be 2 years. All right. He may say, I need to do something else because his qualifications will push him out to something else. Just because I think the money is not enough.
I don't know that without a lot more experience, from what I understand, entry-level architectural jobs are actually fairly low paid, right?
Yeah, but he's not entry-level, that's the problem.
Well, to get if he wanted to work in architecture, he would be entry-level. He would be entry-level.
But he's also mentioned he had a hard time finding those positions.
I think probably for the same reason we're discussing now, he's overqualified for so many jobs, and yet he's underqualified in that he doesn't have that. Like, he's in some ways overqualified for an entry-level architectural job, right?
Yeah, he's got like, what, a few years of architecture, but, you know.
Not even actual architecture, does he?
No.
Yeah,
but
I guess.
It's not like he has 25, 30 years experience.
No. Well, first off, he hasn't focused in on one thing.
Right.
All right? And that kind of leads me to, I don't necessarily know if he'll be focused in on this particular job either.
Well, he's been a student for 17 years.
Okay. What does that tell you?
It means that he wanted an academic track, and you know what? He hasn't been successful at getting an academic track.
He would be the first person that happened to.
I just went through this with a family member who was on a tenure track position and was not happy with the academic situation and left to take a job that she's was told to be grossly overqualified for it. She's ecstatic that they gave her the job. Ecstatic.
No, trust me, you'll be ecstatic too, but I'm just wondering if this won't fill his need because of his expectations of what he was going to do in the world.
Well, you know.
Okay, that's my concern.
So let me just share this with you because, like, in my career in banking, like right now, there seems to be this, like, there's just a glut of people who are retiring. You know, the technology has, like, just advanced so far that, you know, the people who were kind of holding on and, you know, like, to get out of the house and go be a teller for a couple, it's gotten beyond them. And so now, the employment pool that I'm looking at for tellers is people right out of college because they can't find jobs. So I've got, you know, people who are far more qualified than me, you know, with business degrees and stuff like that, who are, you know, doing part-time tellering and stuff like that. So I think it's a lot of it is just the way the world is changing. You know, I think if we look at somebody like Rachel or even Deborah, I think those are fine if you want to keep the status quo, if we want to, you know, keep moving and try to grow this.
I thought that Rachel had the experience to help us grow based on her legislative experience.
Yeah.
You know, she is employed by the town, and she lives in town, which I think is a plus. My real concern is, like Paul just said, that I don't think Matthew's going to stay.
Right. Well, the other thing is that, and this board talked about it too, is we need somebody who can get in here, can get moving quickly, and can understand how this place works. The advantage of having Rachel, she already knows all the players in the town hall.
Is
that
an advantage?
Yes.
An advantage or disadvantage?
I asked the same question.
I mean,
I think it is an advantage.
Okay.
I think Rachel's very qualified, don't get me wrong. I do think that she's qualified. I'm not trying to say that she's not. I'm just saying that Matthew brings something that no one else can because he's overqualified. And, you know,
right.
So you see overqualified as a deficit, and I see it as an asset.
That's true. I look at it as our expectations of asking for an awful lot from the individual that's taking this position, number one, to do things that, one, they're not compensated for, all right? Realistically, because at one time we were talking about having the clerk and a town planner, and we're trying to roll both of those into one, all right, for short money,
yep.
Because it fits into narrative.
Sounds like
a great deal.
but I'm saying this is that we may be going looking for that, but you may not be getting that. We may get a person in here that one, like I said, is overqualified, and the other may be fine for a short period of time. But I think his need to do what he's doing, education-wise and everything else, is going to drive him out of this position.
I think he's kind of done with education.
Everyone's done it to education until they get into a job they really don't want to do.
Then, can I ask why the committee chose Deborah?
I think the feeling was, okay, I can speak for myself rather than for the committee. Deborah was a strong customer service person. I think sometimes it's easier to have someone who's not in the town and doesn't have local biases and ties that could influence the work of someone who should be fairly neutral except to carry out the purposes of the board. So I think
she
Deborah
also
was seen
had a very consistent
employment
record.
Yeah.
Right.
So she had a very strong employment record, a very consistent work record, and a lot of customer service experience and seemed to be able to handle environments in which she's getting challenged a lot.
Right.
And so we thought that she's the, so that they're very, what's interesting to me is that they each one of them bring strengths. and
I agree.
You know, and it's not, and it makes the decision to me a little bit more difficult because it's not comparing apples to apples and saying, well, this person's a little bit stronger. You're comparing three kind of, an apple, an orange, and a banana.
Right.
And do we want an apple, an orange, or a banana? You know?
I think we're down to pick it between the apple and the
orange. I don't necessarily think we should use the banana analogy, but that's all right.
Get your mind back to the table.
I'll be honest with you, I thought out of all of them that we talked to, I thought Deborah presented the best. I thought she was, she just made a great presentation with the screening committee. I sat there and kind of felt like she could do anything.
So.
Yes, one thing is kind of, I thought Rachel and Deborah were kind of neck and neck between the two of them, but I am hearing Rachel and Matthew were available immediately.
Yeah, but you don't want to leave a small gap in availability to start to keep you away from a great candidate either.
Right.
But
well, we're very close at Mayo. I mean,
when they're this close,
it's a factor.
What I want to ask Jim, what's your opinion of Matthew?
He'd be my choice.
Okay.
Just because of all the, what he brings to the table. We had a couple of candidates that did have some planning experience and knowledge of GIS and AutoCAD and MicroStation, like all the software the Merrill Associates would use. And we picked Matthew up and a couple of others. And that's what we presented here.
Okay. You don't feel that
he was the stronger of the two when it, on the planning side.
You don't feel he's a whole lot of that.
Not really. I mean, I have a master's, but I'm going to go up to Somerville tonight and look into sewer manholes all night.
Yeah, no. I mean, I
am. That's
if that's what your master in, that's what your master.
I understand what you're saying.
No. And I think you can't look at.
I mean, Paul, you know a lot of electrical stuff, but you spend several hours a day just pumping stuff around.
Both
and,
you guys get compensated a lot more than what we're going to compensate this position.
That's my point. Right.
So, that's my
point. I don't think this person, I don't think Matthew, if he's been a lecturer for a couple of years, I don't know what other jobs he's had to keep himself going, because those probably didn't pay enough.
I understand that.
They probably paid
per diems.
Per diems. I'm thinking half of what we pay.
You think so? Yeah. And they're not all year long, right? They're just semester and all that.
And I think we have enough, right now we have enough, we can push this up to the top of the, I feel comfortable that after our union stuff there, that it was kind of indicated to me that we could push this position up to the third level, which would be the high end of the position.
All right. If we chose a candidate like that, how soon would we be able to hire them?
Well, there's two who can start immediately.
Yeah.
So
I think we just have to take a vote on who we want. I do think that Rachel, if I had to pick between Rachel and Deborah, for me, the fact that Deborah's out of town is nice, but I still think that Rachel probably has more directly relevant experience. I think Rachel could pick up the ball and run with it more quickly because she has, knows some of the logistical stuff about preparing legal notices and posting meeting dates and keeping minutes. So some of that logistical stuff I think Rachel could probably pick up more quickly than Deborah, and I think she, I don't think she has the extensiveness of experience that Deborah has in the world and in customer relations, but I think that she has strong experience more recently, like in the last 3 years. So I'm not sure why she left the administrative assistant job to take a part-time job. That's one thing I wish I had asked her.
Rachel?
Yeah.
It's family.
Right. I think she has two children.
Three.
We have to be very careful about speaking about that being relevant.
No, but I'm just...
No, it is relevant.
That could be the part of the reason, that's all. And it doesn't matter...
Although the other job was just in Brockton, it wasn't far away.
Right.
It's more like having a local job.
And we didn't ask if that was like a full-time position or if that was...
If that was also part-time.
Well, she was on the advisory committee. He gave that up to be on the to go to the part-time position with CPC because it would be a conflict.
Yeah. So, one of the big strengths that Rachel brings to the table is the fact that she already understands how these boards kind of work.
Right.
So, you know, the posting of the agendas, the handling
the minutes,
handling public hearings, making sure people are notified of public hearings, those things. That's the toughest part of this. That's the one thing I worry about with a candidate like Matthew is those are really mundane tasks that have to be done on a regular basis.
So don't you get the impression that he would do a spreadsheet pretty quickly to schedule that out?
Yeah.
The other thing we haven't talked about is there was another candidate that we did not invite back because we tried to keep it pretty narrow, but there was another candidate who also had some town hall experience and but had less overall work experience. If anybody wanted to see the other resumes, we have them available.
No, I don't think that's necessary at this point.
She had come to a couple of our meetings.
Yeah, okay, I understand what you said.
I think
yeah.
You know, I think I kind of, you know, and I say this all the time too. When I hire a teller who's just come out of school and stuff like that, you don't expect them to be with you for very long. But they do bring a lot to the table, and I think it's worth taking the shot.
With Matthew.
Yeah.
Definitely would be a different type of applicant to bring to the town hall environment.
Well, I'll tell you something. One of the things was an email I got from Ed was, when we kind of had been talking here was, this like almost like the three question marks. Are you guys actually thinking about a town planner? We haven't, his second sentence was, we haven't had one in 25 years or something like that.
Right. It was sort of,
like, we've always done it this way.
Right. And I think it does sort of push the boundaries to have someone with Matthew's experience to be able to say, hey, what else could we and should we be looking at? What else, a town our size that's at this stage of growth, that's at this stage of, we don't have 20 subdivisions a year right now because we don't have that kind of land. So the land we do use starts to become more scarce. And how it's used becomes almost more important because
you're kind of limited too as to what you're going to be able to plan.
Design.
First off, is that take the center for instance.
Yeah.
Right, you have a site plan comes in to this. What? Just tell me what he's going to do. What having a town planner was going to do to change that?
Oh, I don't know if he'll change a specific site plan review so much as I don't think that this board is only supposed to be doing site plan reviews and subdivision reviews.
But to answer your question, though, Paul, is that there may have been some preliminary traffic analysis done on the center, so when Cumberland Farms comes in with a relatively large project, the board is prepared to ask for something very specific based on where the intersection is, or isn't what's that, abutting it,
right.
all of those questions.
But isn't that what we're doing with our town engineer?
Right, but we have to pay extra for all of that?
No, the applicant pays for it.
But if he has time and the interstices, he might be able to give us
another thing that always comes up, though, is when we do a new zoning bylaw, it's kind of always like, well, what do other towns do? Well, Matthew can go off research it and come back and say, well, this is what's going on elsewhere.
Isn't Rachel more apt to be able to get us grants
I think she'd be good at going and finding them, but I think Matthew would be able to write a much stronger grant application.
I mean, one of the other things is, you know, thinking with Bryson Way, we just heard, you know, a couple of these abutters talking about how dense it is over there, you know, and is he the type of guy who can say, you know, does it make sense? Is this, are these, you know, when we get something like this, can you look at this? You know, does this bylaw even make sense in that area?
Well, first off, if I heard out of him, is basically he was checking sewer lines, things like that.
He had two different things. He had comprehensive site plans, and then he said as a secondary thing, right, there were overlapping service issues.
Right, but to me, I don't necessarily know the part of what he was doing was necessarily any planning. I think it was looking at plans based on different things, just like we sent out to the engineer.
He's written a chapter in a book on zoning in the controlled space of modernity.
Do we get a copy of that?
I'm sure we can if we want to buy this book, Across Space and Time, Architecture and the Politics of Modernity.
What is it? Architecture?
Across Space and Time, Architecture.
So it's aerial.
Edited by Patrick Haughey.
Visuals on that would be crazy.
Right.
And Finding Common Ground Between New Urbanism and Landscape Urbanism. He's also done some shipping issues, which are not really particularly useful for us.
Right. I just think that he's. I just think he hasn't really found himself, and hasn't concentrated on one particular area. And I tend to think, we don't need to probably go much further, because everyone has an opinion, I think, on each applicant. But I do think that yes, you know, when you first look at it, you know, he exceeds the criteria, but almost to the point of, to me, is that this is a stepping stone to get back into the workforce. I think that's my point.
Is that bad?
No, but it is. It is for this board. If it's going to actually have to keep rehiring in the future.
Well, there's a little bit of risk with that. Yes.
There's a risk with anybody, though.
There could be risk with anybody. Right,
Mr. Chairman. And this one, we take an initial vote?
Well, this one may be a risk we'd want to take. Because in the short term, there could be a lot that we get out of this. And then in the long term, we may find that there's enough of that planning experience that could lead us down the path to a planner at some point in time. Not that we can make any promises on that.
Right, and is how, I mean, doing up an agenda, is that, you know, you do it once and you get your template, and you're basically just plopping people on in half-hour increments.
But that's just a tactical thing that people do.
Right, right.
I think what I was trying to get at with the applicants tonight was, who are you going to work with? Who's got the priority? Who's the people that you report to?
Right.
And I think they got it in this planning board. I think both Matthew and Rachel kind of understood that. You know, and that's where we go with emotional intelligence as well. It's not so much knowing what to do, but how you do it, and how you work with the public, and how you interact with people that can make or break someone in a position. They could have all the skills in the world. They could be the smartest people in the world. But if they can't work with people, you could have a disaster on your hands.
That's going to be part of the key to this position, is how you handle the board.
Unless we're all sitting working with them day in and day out, I think we're going to take a leap of faith.
Well, I feel on that issue, all three applicants did fine tonight. I didn't see any red flags come up on that.
No, they were. I think they're all three strong applicants. I think that at the end of the day, I would probably be choosing between Rachel and Matthew, myself. Because I just thought that in tonight's presentation, I thought Rachel was a little stronger. And I think her experience, like if I were going to go with
that type of experience, I would say her experience would be a little more quickly usable. But I think I still sort of come out on the side of Matthew offering us something different that's worth exploring and trying to bring him in. And I think it's not a typical person for this role, but I think that he could be very good at the role.
Although on the other hand,
I think I'd prefer myself to go with the safe bet.
What's that?
The safe bet to me, it would be Rachel, number one. But because if you want to have somebody that has a planning background, I think that we need to take and go to get somebody who's going to have a planning background and have somebody who can, somebody with support of that particular person would be, in other words, if we would hire Rachel, then we look for the idea of going to the planner stage.
But we don't have money for it.
We don't have money for it. We've always never had money for it.
Well, and that's the problem, so we never get to that second
stage.
Well,
I'm going to tell you, I work in Situate, they've got a planner there that they're paying $85,000 a year who's doing no planning. Basically just overseeing meetings.
Exactly, and there's my point.
But I think he could give us that level.
It would be paying him for overseeing meetings.
No, but we're assuming a lot, because first off is that, yes, the mundane things may overwhelm him, where the other things may not. He's a speaker, so I mean, he may be great in the theoretical portion of it, and not necessarily, we're assuming an awful lot that he'd be great in the clerical portion of this. Applicant, where the primary job of this right now is clerical. All right, and we're looking into something else that.
I want somebody who can understand the rules and regs. I want someone who can. That if Brian's not here one night, someone who can help us go through the rules and regs and make a decision.
But that's not Matthew.
I think Matthew can get to that point.
Matthew could get to that point in a year or so.
Yeah, but I don't know that the other applicants are going to get to that point, because they don't.
It's a small book of the bylaws. It's not like a Bible. It's not that overwhelming.
I think he understands what's supposed to be in bylaws. I think he understands what's supposed to be in rules and regs.
It's like a thick magazine.
I was going for the safe bet of all of the things that we're required by statute to do, which I know that Rachel can handle. We think that Matthew would be a great combination of planner clerical. I'm not necessarily sure that's the truth. So I would be going for the safe bet for the board.
I think at this point,
Brian?
I mean, clerical, part of clerical is that filing cabinet over there.
Part of clerical is the minutes, making sure everything's stamped
right,
in.
But it's also partially that filing cabinet over there. And I think I added to the regulations maybe 20 years ago that each as-built that comes in, we got an AutoCAD file.
So have you, considering you were the author of that, did you ever?
Yeah, we got several in, and no one was ever able to do anything.
Did you ever go back and look at that?
Yeah, we had a box of them somewhere, but no one was ever able to do anything with them.
Well, that's the problem. We didn't have the
wasted
capability.
Well, we have them up at the assessor's office, and the DPW is working on the same system.
What system?
Yeah, but let me ask a question. How valuable is that to the planning board? I mean, once the subdivision's done, as-builts are done,
I don't think it's that
aren't they more important to the DPW than the planning
board? They're important to everyone.
It all gets linked together.
I know, but the planning board's not going to have any jurisdiction over that subdivision after it's accepted.
Once they're brought in, they go over.
You're losing that. My point is you're losing that. Why do we keep that then?
Well, that's something that...
Because that's when people come in, they want to see it physically. Like, I want to see that board.
Years from now, they're going to get on the town website and want to go to the GIS and pull it up on their screen.
Are we in a position where we can start to discuss?
I think that Marilyn actually has to go research site plans and things for people who come in, realtors who come in, and other people come in. I've heard her talk about it. And if we had that information maintained, we wouldn't constantly be pulling out files. It would be, here it is. We can electronically search and find it, and we don't lose a day of clerical work going to look for it in the files.
I've asked Marilyn for files that she's brought me into the back room over there where you're digging through boxes like this
People expect you to be able to send this stuff out, you know, by email or zip file or whatever.
I mean, I think the world is changing, but we're not changing with it.
Right, but I'm assuming that Rachel could do that too. I mean, if it's just a zip file held into a file, she obviously could do that.
Well, I'll combine them together and add them to our GIS system.
Can we take
them
to the board to see how we stand?
You can do whatever you like.
Okay. Well, Mr. Chairman,
are we ready for that?
Yeah, I think we're ready for that.
Okay.
So, I guess I don't really know how we do this.
Let's just do a roll call again.
Rather than someone moving for an applicant to be hired, we just do a roll call.
I'll move that
we hire Matthew Hines to fill the position of planning board assistant/agent.
Second.
So now you can do a roll call.
All right. So we'll do a roll call. Ms. Kaleva. Well, you made the motions.
Aye.
Mr. Irv.
No.
Jim.
I seconded it.
Oh, that's true. Andy?
Aye.
Okay.
No.
Oh, all right. I'm an aye.
You're an aye?
Yeah.
So that solves the problem.
I'm just taking notes for the record in case there's a problem with that.
Okay. For some reason, we were all waiting for you. I don't know why.
I'm just taking notes here, people.
Okay. If that's the case, are we done?
I guess we're done. So we get a motion to adjourn.
Take a motion to adjourn.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
No.